next on the bench is a Schatz anniversary clock. We'll be doing a full overhaul to this. I don't know if I want to lift this up while I have you on video, because the glass may slip out of my hand, and this truly is a piece of glass. Some of the newer ones, and also replacement domes, you can buy them in plastic, but the glass ones are always nicer, so be very careful with them. What we'll be doing is a overhaul to this particular clock movement, which does not function, by the way, and get it up and running. Most probably have to replace the suspension spring and possibly the mainspring, but we'll see that once we remove it from the barrel. First thing about anniversary clocks is they are extremely sensitive to being perfectly level. The reason for that is that the rotary pendulum has to swing and turn inside of its little cup here. It's not actually touching anything inside the cup, but if it's crooked, it'll hit the sides of the cup, and if that happens, it'll stop just like it is right now. Other things to look at: whenever you're working with any kind of a clock with a spring, you have to let down the mainspring. To do that, they got this little click handle that you push up on it. So in order to let this click down, let's say it's got a couple of winds in it, like that. Whoop. Okay, so right now we have to consider this a dangerous clock. We do not want to take it apart, because if we do, that spring is going to jump apart just before we come apart, and it'll damage the wheels as well as the pivots. Right? It seems like everything we do may cause a problem. So you just kind of get ready with all of them. That's what this video is all about, is to help you build the confidence that these little things that will bite you in the butt, that are unknown to you, I will bring them to your attention. Okay, here's the third one. It doesn't look like there's an inside or outside to this collar, so it doesn't matter how you put them back on. And this guy should just come right off. As you can see, there's three of them. Only goes on one way because the porcelain portion is in there, just like that. And you might be able to see that cone shape where that collar actually fit on. I'm doing this so the camera will focus. Is it easier to see? Hopefully. Okay. Now, these porcelain dials in the hands, I like to use these little for sandwich meats that you can buy. These are the greatest tubs in the world for clock repair, because they're small enough not to get in your way on the bench. They're soft enough where they won't scratch any components, and they're big enough to hold apart. The movement plate, and doing some more analyzing before we take apart the click assembly, and make sure you don't lose these collars and screws. There's one for the top that hold that previous tube on, and one for the bottom. Okay, we're going to take this apart again. And we're just going to put everything inside of the little rack so everything has a place. Got the escape wheel, the minute arbor, T1, T2, T3, T4. T3, T2, and the barrel. This is the rack that's about to go into the ultrasonic. You can do all of this stuff by hand cleaning. There really is no difference, except the ultrasonic just eliminates me having to brush it by hand. You can use the same cleaning fluid as the ultrasonic. I use water base that has ammonia in it, which puts a really nice bright shiny finish on the brass component. The plates generally Since they are lacquered, you want to be very careful with them. You don't want to use any kind of carburetor cleaner because that'll attack it. And even though it won't lift it right away, it'll cause a cloudiness on top and get rid of its sheen. So just regular isopropyl alcohol will be more than enough to get the outside
clean.
And
we're right out of the ultrasonic cleaner. And we went over and we just rinsed it off in some hot water. And then I immediately picked up all the pieces and hand dried them and put them back in the rack right side up and in their relative order of what they're supposed to be. Here's the barrel, got cleaned up real nice. Here's the barrel cap, he got cleaned up real nice. And I put it in all of the dried pieces inside of a dry rack. I have two racks. I try to keep one dry at all times. This is the polishing jig that I'm going to be using to do the wheels. All this is a Jacob's chuck off of a hand drill that I've adapted through this into my lathe. You can use anything that spins the chuck, just like the hand drill itself, as long as you can lock it in the running position and you can adjust it to the lowest setting. You want it to be going very slow. And the 3/8 chuck is excellent because it grabs about 90% of everything that you'll be polishing. I'll show you in a second how it grabs the arbors and how to do the polishing. I found that the escape wheel does not have enough tilt towards the top of the movement. It has enough going towards the bottom, but not the top. And also the minute arbor, it probably has enough tilt to it, but it interferes with the tilt of the escape wheel arbor there. So what we're going to do is to loosen this guy up a little bit by taking out using our very small five-sided brooch. Put the spring back into the barrel. First thing we need to do is I like to use the Ollie spring winder. You can use one that you make by Joe Collins. It's made of maple. It does the job the same way. Some people say they like it better than the Ollie, but the Ollie is something that I could buy and start using right away. The Joe Collins one, you need to make it or have it built by Joe Collins. Contact me if you need to get Joe Collins's information. Okay, first of all, we got ourselves a little spring here. And we put the winding arbor in correctly because it only catches one way. It catches right there, so when this thing winds, it's going to wind in that direction there. So we look at the way the spring is and we put it in correctly. And what we want to do is to first capture it inside of this little tube of metal with a little U-shaped piece, and that allows the end of the spring to be stuck out. You'll see what that means in a second. Put the tailstock up against it. These little hooks here, they capture that particular spring. Let's see if it holds it properly. Whoop. You want to put the little hook assembly right underneath it, otherwise you're going to get all kinds of crazy movement out of it. Okay, we got that wound up. This spring is dry right now. I only lubricate them until after they're in the barrel. I move this little sleeve over it and leave it flush with the end of the spring right here. I don't shove it in all the way. I leave it flush because we need to put this into the barrel, and if it was in all the way, this spring would never get into the barrel all the way. So what we want to do here is hit the little ratchet there, hold this, and
And what that does, it simply puts the spring inside of this little sleeve here, with the edge of the spring sticking out just the way you see it. May want to straighten that out a little. I had bent that in order to make it accessible to take it out earlier. It'll reform itself as we put the movement together here, and we need to get the mainspring in there, but a couple of these wheels are in the way. This is the back plate, by the way. Go ahead and get him in there. Like that. Put the minute arbor back in. He's in. Put the second time wheel in. And then put this little booger on there. Now, whenever you go to putting these pivots in, it's always quite interesting, because especially with the French movements and these anniversary clocks, they're so small that it's hard to tilt anything in order to get everything in at one time. So try to hold it kind of stable. Don't feel bad if you can't do it the first time around. Just keep practicing.
Now, this is the way you buy the springs from the hull of our company. They have 24 different thicknesses. They call them strengths. So get used to that word, strength. That means how thick the spring is, and that also gives it the spring the strength. This package is just has the 4/1000ths, 0.0040 inches. This is the millimeter equivalent. You don't have to look at that. 4/1000ths is what we need to know. Inside this package, there's probably 3 springs, and I think it costs $4 to $6 for this little pack, and it comes with 3. Is the pallets, the way they lock. And the pallets, let me see if I can zoom in there for you. You'll see the suspension spring kind of twisting. We have the teeth landing about 10% onto the flat side of each one of the pallets. And then you see the tooth pushing off on the 45 degree angle, pushing the verge upwards for each tick and tock. Every time it hits that 45 degree angle there, it actually impulses the pendulum to make it turn. I'll show you in a minute why that happens, but for right now, just so you can hear what it's supposed to sound like. Here comes the impulse on the left. As soon as it ticks, the impulse on the other side pushes the pendulum, pushing it right there. And now the one on the left, pushing, finished. Now the one on the right. Since there is a sliding motion there, it's good to put some very fine oil on that, and that allows the brass, the tip of the brass tooth, to polish the steel pallet and make it easier, kind of like a break-in period. Whenever you change something, it needs to be broken in a little bit.